brain can do that twice. That's too much. Well, it's a delight to be in an actual church building. I heard about those things. I kind of forgot what it was like. Yeah, they're still up, aren't they? But I'd love to see all of you here today. I'm a retired pastor, retired about 2.5 years ago. And right after retiring, I came here as sort of an interim part-time preacher while we were looking for a wife. And it became it was a divine providence. I had a heart attack right at that week and got an opportunity to almost meet Jesus. I feel a little rejected because basically said, no, it's not your time. You're going to stay here a little while longer. So this is my assignment, to continue to run the race that God has called me to run. Some few years back, I felt the need to get in shape again. I was getting older, in my early 60s. And so I got a Runner's World magazine and read about how to start running again. It gave an outline of the preparation. First, training. You don't run, you train first. It mentioned walking for 6 weeks briskly at different distances that are comfortable, doing cross training, doing some spinning, even some upper body work, and then incrementally running more and more until you build yourself up to a point where you could run a 5K, a 3.1-mile race. And this took many months to accomplish. So I followed all the things that I was told to do in training, did them all, and came to the point where I thought, you know, I should engage in the race. I should get in a race. I had a number of friends of mine who worked for Verizon, and they told me, you should get in the Verizon 5K. Are you familiar with that race in Marstown? It's a giant race. It's 5,200 people signed up and paid up to go to that race. And some of my friends, some of them ran it. So I'd never run before in a race, many years at least, even though I did it a lot as a young man. So I wasn't sure where it really fit. So I got at the very end of the pack, the very last group of people. If you know anything about running, they stagger you depending on what time you think you're going to run. So I got way back at the end. I just discovered way at the end of the line, by the way, 5,200 people signed up, 4,200 people showed up. And I found that to be typically the case. Roughly 20% of the people don't even show. They say, well, maybe I should as it gets closer. No, I'm not. And I discovered at the end of the line were a bunch of young mothers with their tricycle strollers and their babies inside. I'm a little embarrassed, but now, oh, yeah, I hit myself. And then we started to run. After about a half a mile of running, I felt stronger and able to move on. I thought, maybe I should pass some of these folks. So I began a very long, arduous process of weaving in and out of people. And I tell you, as I ran through that crowd, I discovered something. Some of those people should have never have been there. I remember particularly one giant guy that would have been 6, 7 inches taller than me, and at least 300 some pounds. There's no way on God's green earth. He must not be married, that's all I can say. Because if he was, his wife would have said, no, you're not running in that race. You're sitting home, have another bagel. So I managed to logistically navigate my way around his large frame. I was afraid at any moment, seriously, I'm not kidding. I was afraid at any moment he was going to have a heart stroke and I'd trip over him and hurt myself. So when you see these kinds of things, you realize why they have these EMS teams at all these races. They need to be there. And many people are like that. They are not trained. They're not prepared to run. As they weave back and forth, I finally came to about the last mile. If you ever run, that's the worst. The final mile is hard because no matter how hard you think and you're going to hold yourself back, you end up running faster than you planned to run. So you're a lot more extended. And as I got to the last one, I thought, I'm not going to give up. I'm going to persevere. I'm going to endure. I'm going to go to the end. But I remember coming, seeing the long street and seeing the finish line. And that's where you strain towards the finish line. You give it all you got. He said, I did. Why is there? I'm rising at my age. And I ran through the finish line. And I discovered I had come in 1,200th. I had literally passed 3,000 people to get to the finish line. Running is something that is not new to mankind. Running was very popular in the Apostle Paul's day. he grew up in a Hellenistic culture that featured sports in a huge way. Their primary sports would be what we call track and field today, with the addition of boxing and wrestling. They were taught these sports while they were in school. If you went to a Greek Hellenistic school, which is Hellenistic Greek influence extended throughout the Middle East, including where Paul was. And they had, of course, their Olympic Games once every 4 years. And this is a staggering thing, if you think about it. They had the Olympics for 1,000 years. Can you imagine? Every 4 years, for 1,000 years. And when parties were fighting each other at war, they would stop the war, go to the Olympic Games, run against each other, beat each other in matches, then go back to war after the game of war. They had to go over and over again. They had the Isthmian Games in between these games. Those were the games at Corinth. Paul ministered in Corinth. Scholars believe that he, with his friends, Priscilla and Aquila, were making tents for the participants and the audience that would go to those games in Corinth. Paul spent 3 years in Ephesus. Ephesus, the stadium in Ephesus, they estimate can hold, get this, this is antiquity, but over 2,000 years ago, that held 100,000 people. These are massive events. They were their Stanley Cup playoffs. They were their Super Bowl. They were their NFL, you know, playoffs. They were their World Series. Everything was focused on those events. So huge, massive events that went on for many years. And the reason for this in the Greek mind is they had this concept of a perfect man in body, soul, and mind. Their mind was developed through rhetoric and grammar and mathematics. Their soul through their religious pursuits. And their body through physical training, which they preached and advocated and practiced for many, many centuries. So Paul knew the language and the culture of his day. He grew up in it. It's conceivable he might have even participated in some of these running kinds of things while he was a schoolboy, since he certainly would have been offered the opportunity to do so, given that he was born a Roman citizen. So we see in the scriptures many different places in Paul who refers to the games, competing in the various Greek games, using running and pugilistic boxing metaphors. One of those particular passages is in 1 Corinthians 9, 24 to 27. He writes these words, "Do you not know that in a race, all the runners run, but only one is the prize?" And I like this line. Run in such a way as to get the prize. In other words, run to win. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last. But we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, I do not run like a man running aimlessly. I do not fight like a man beating the air. No, I beat my body and make it my slave so that after I preach to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. When I was a young seminary student, some guys would joke about that as we read the King James Bible, where it says, I buffet my body. I buffet my body and discipline to righteousness. Too many Americans buffet their body and then beat their body. That's a lesson to us all, a lesson that I had to learn as well. So we look at these scriptures and we see the first thing that we need to do is, Paul says everyone who competes in these games goes into strict training. In another companion passage, Paul writes in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7, the latter part of that verse, he says, train yourself to be godly. For physical training, in verse 8, for physical training is of some value. But godliness has value for all things, holding promise both for the present and the future. Again, like the philosophers and teachers of his day, who you regularly use athletic metaphors to teach truths about self-discipline, perseverance, and endurance. Can I tell the sun for a glass of water? So he was using the language and culture of the day to teach spiritual truths about running the race that God has marked out for us. So that begs the question, train yourself to be godly. So what exactly does one do to train themselves to be godly? As I reflected on that point, I thought, what is the most important thing? The As a young Christian, I became a Christian and a believer in Jesus Christ while I was a student in college at Northern Michigan University. And I remember the line that people would say, you gotta keep the main thing the main thing. So what is the main thing? When you reflect back on Jesus' teaching, what does he call the greatest commandment? What is the greatest commandment? Love. Is that the most important thing to God, the most important thing we need to do, you and I, train ourselves to godliness, is to learn to love, to have a heart for God. To love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, and mind. Now the Greek-speaking world, and the Greeks speaking this Old Testament, the Greek-speaking world, they had a Old Testament written in Greek called the Septuagint. And in that version, they talk about loving the Lord your God with all your whole heart, soul, mind, and strength. Because in the Greek language, and translated from Hebrew to Greek, they understood there was a dual meaning in the heart. It also meant physical or body strength. With everything that's in you, you love God. So we read in Luke 10, when Jesus is talking with someone and asks him, what is the most important thing, was the greatest commandment? That fellow quotes that verse, the Septuagint. It says, we must love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, our mind, and our strength. That sort of heart was to me the Greek idea of the perfect man. The perfect man or woman of God is someone who loves God with their mind and their intellect, with their soul and relationship with God, with their heart and their emotions and their feeling and their compassion, and with their strength, their body, in service to Jesus Christ. The perfect follower of Jesus Christ. So that's the most important thing, to develop a heart for God. But when you think about love, it's interesting to me to reflect on what's called the Upper Room Discourse in John 13 through 17. I had an exciting time. I went with my Bible study guys that I met with for 25 years. This last year, we all decided to get together, and with our wives' permission, and maybe even wishes, we all went to Israel together. Seven of us. And we had a fantastic time. I remember being in the places where they said these actual events took place. And I can't, if you've ever been to Israel, I advocate going there. Because every time I read a verse, now my mind goes back to where it was when that verse took place. And I'm seeing it right now in my head. Well, what do you need to do to love God? Well, Jesus defined love in an unusual way, not in the way that you and I would normally do it without the Word of God to guide us. He says in John 14, 21, two different places, whoever has my commands and obeys them, he is one. You know how it goes? He is the one who loves God. God defines love by doing what he tells us to do. That's how we know that we love him, that we honor his name. Whoever has the commands of God and obeys them, he is the one who loves me. And he says, Jesus speaking, I too will love him, my Father will love him, and I will show myself to him. If you want to see God in your life, you got to do what God tells you to do. God, that's how we express our love to the Father. It's with our strength, with our bodies, and what we do. When I think about the Word, the value of the Word, I recall the proof text of the Bible of what's called verbal plenary inspiration. All that means is all the words are inspired by God. It's a verse I'm sure many of you know by heart. It's 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. And I love this beginning phrase where it says, all scripture is God-breathed. I love that word, God-breathed. That's why the word of God is living and active, it says in Hebrews 4:12. And it's possible that Paul actually wrote that word as well, Hebrews. The word of God is living because God breathed living into it. What's the other thing that God breathed in? The only other thing? Us. He breathed into our ancestor Adam. That's what made Adam different from all the other creatures. We have the breath of God, the image of God in us. God breathed into us his spirit. And he breathed into his word his spirit. And so we have in the Bible the living, breathing word, the living, active, and breathing word of God. And so that verse says, all scripture is God breathed and is useful or profitable for four things: for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. so that the man of God, that's the word that's narrated for mankind, men and women, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Not like the definition of teaching, rebuking, and correcting, and training in righteousness like this. God's word teaches us what is right. God's word rebukes us in regard to what is wrong. God's word corrects us in regard to how to get right when we've been wrong. And God's word trains us in righteousness and how to stay right. That's the value of the word of God. If you want to train yourself to be a godly person, you develop a heart for God. Above all else, to love God. And secondly, to love your neighbor as yourself. There's nothing more important than that. I remember reading a famous apologist years ago of the Navigators, and he was giving all these apologetic defenses of the gospel, you know, manuscript evidence, Old Testament evidence, archaeological evidence, fulfillment of biblical prophecy, those kinds of things. And they're important. They said, the most important apologetic is love. That's the number one thing God calls us to do. Love Him first, and love each other second. It's well to keep that in mind if you wish to be a godly person. So that's how you get trained for every good work. That's the positive things you need to do. You need to get yourself in shape, in spiritual shape. But there's also some things you need to avoid doing. And that's my second point. You got to forget what is behind. You can't hang on the past if you want to get into the future. You can't look back if you want to get ahead. Any runner is just positive. If you try to look behind you, you're going to fall flat on your face. That's what's going to happen to you. And in the immediate and extended context, Paul refers to two types of things not to look back at. In the beginning of chapter 3 of Philippians, where he gives this running passage in verses 12 to 14 while pressing on towards the prize, he says, and then he says, one thing I do is a two-part runner. I forget what is behind, and then it says, I strain towards what is ahead. Let's look at forgetting what is behind first. In the beginning of that chapter, Paul talks about his accomplishments, the things that he did to try and earn his way to God. He tried to earn a righteousness that was not by faith, but was by works. And everybody who does that will fail. That will not work. If you're working to get to God, you're not going to be able to work hard enough. You will fail. And it was part of the self-righteous. I call it a self-righteous coin. That's the one side of the accomplishment side. Paul goes on to say that this knowing Christ was his passive greatness. Knowing Christ was more than all the things he had done and all the things he had done bad. All those works meant nothing in the end. He rather would have a righteousness that is by faith and not by works. A righteousness that is by faith in Jesus Christ and not by checking off a bunch of little boxes, as he said, in regards to legalistic righteousness, faultless. I believe Paul was a straight-A student, probably valedictorian of his self-righteousness class. Well, if you look at that, and that's the kind of person you are, remember, those are the kind of people that actually killed Jesus. Those are the kind of people that fought the gospel of love, the self-righteous. And we have too much of that attitude even in the Christian church. You can't focus on a righteousness that's earned. You focus on a righteousness that's given and received. And that requires true ability. Do not be proud. I remember reading a comment by C.S. Lewis, you know who he is. He said, the proud cannot know God. All the self-righteous people who are going to say, look at me, God, look what I did, as the Pharisees did in Jesus' day, while they beat their chest in pride. Well, he compared that to another man in Luke 18, who was a tax collector, beating his chest in shame, looking down, forgive me, a sinner. God wants true ability, not arrogance and pride. That's the self-righteous side of that coin. And Paul gladly threw that in the trash, in the garbage, because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus Lord, for whose sake he lost all things. The other side of that coin, we learn this from another context in Paul's talking, is the things you're ashamed of. Your guilt. That's another side of the self-righteous coin. If you're a self-righteous person and you're trying to earn your way to God, there's the good things you're doing, but then there's the opposite side, the things that you've done that you should have done that you're ashamed of. And Paul talked about that in his description, referring to his past life as a persecutor of the church. He says that over in 1 Timothy. He he talks about not just simply being a sinner. He says, I am the worst of sinners. I persecuted the church. But instead of wallowing in the mire of his guilt, remember, he had been involved in killing people, innocent Christian people, putting them in prison, men and women. And he looks at what he did, and he talks about this in 1 Timothy chapter 1. I was the worst of sinners, yet because I did it in the world, he was shown the greatest of mercy. He didn't wallow in the mire. He praised the God of grace who forgave even someone like him. In order to run, you got to get rid of the things that hold you back and trip you up. I've seen this too many times in Christian life. Both the side where I'm proud, that ends your spiritual strength. I decided, I've done so many things, Pastor, I can't possibly serve Jesus Christ. Paul turned that around. Because I've done all these terrible things, look how great Jesus is for forgiving somebody, even the likes of me. So he forgot what is behind. If you want to get ahead, you've got to forget what is behind. Look at the Holy Spirit. Cleanse your conscience from the guilt of your sin. I love the reflection on the fact that when Jesus died, he died for all sin. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us. What? From the sin we confess? No. From all unrighteousness. When you come to Christ, you are forgiven for all the sin you did, all the sin you're doing, and even all the sin you're going to do. That is a good deal. That is praise God, thank you, Jesus. That is grace. When Paul comes to the end of that line where he's talking about him, the worst of sinners, was shown mercy so that Christ might display his unlimited grace even in someone like me, so God will forgive me. He's certainly going to forgive all of you. He ends his line in the first, now this is the first chapter of chapter 1, with this benediction, where it's just a startling benediction. He says, after reflecting on this, now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God, the honor, glory, ever. If you've sinned egregiously, you need to thank God for his grace for forgiving someone even like you, and you need to leave behind if you want to get ahead and run the race that God has marked out for you to run. You see, Paul wasn't good enough to save himself, nor was he bad enough to keep himself from being saved. Grace covers over all pride and guilt. And you got to strain towards what is ahead. That's the other line that Paul uses. Forgetting what is behind, you've got to strain towards what is ahead. Again, that's another running illusion. That word referred to a runner who got rid of all the distractions around him, who focused and fixed on his goal. The word goal in Philippians 3 talks about the goal that he was pursuing, which is Christ-likeness and Christ's service, is the word scope. Now, I come from a very hunting culture. And scope is a big word for us. I didn't know anybody that didn't have one. A scope is what you put on your hunting rifle to go shoot something and eat it. If you think about a scope, if you've ever done that, you have the crosshairs on a scope. If you look out in the field and you're looking for a deer, you're looking for a buck, you see, what, 50, 100, 150 yards of a spectrum, a panorama of view. And if you look it through a scope, what do you see in that crosshairs? Everything is brought down to about that far. Everything else, every other distraction is eliminated. That's because Jesus is telling us through his word, we need to focus and scope on him. He needs to be our aim. He needs to be our goal. In another place, Paul writes in Hebrews 12:2, we need to fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy before him endured the cross. There's previous to that verse in verse 1, it says, we are to run with perseverance the race marked out for us. So we strain. We strain towards that end. Perseverance and endurance are similar and yet somewhat dissimilar words as well. There's an overlapping meaning, but there's also an extended meaning. If I'm persevering, what does that mean? It means I'm not going to give up no matter how long it takes. If I'm enduring, what does that mean? That means I'm not going to give in no matter how hard it gets. Believers are called to persevere and endure, and not give up, and not give in. No matter how long it takes, no matter how hard it gets, you and I are called to pursue that goal. The goal of walking with Jesus Christ, which is spiritual, of doing the good works he's called each of us to do. Salvation is not the end of the race. Salvation is the start. That's where you start. And to begin the work that God has called you to do. But there's more than that. You gotta finish the race right. You gotta fix your eyes and finish the race. Paul writes at the end of his life, this letter to Timothy, I have finished the race. I've kept the faith. I've fought the fight. He writes these words down. And as church history has it, we don't know it from the scripture, but we know it from church history. He writes, now there is in store for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. And he wrote a couple lines after that, rolled up that scroll, handed it to his disciple to take to Timothy, and was immediately taken out next to him. That was literally the last thing the apostle Paul did in service. He finished the race. Now, if you're a runner, I was a runner in high school. Just out of curiosity, did any of you run in sports? Okay. Thank you. One of the things you do, one of the things the coach always taught us is you've got to run through the tape. I had a very good coach. The finish line is not the finish line. The finish line is 10, 15 yards beyond the finish line. You got to run through the finish line. The reason they say that is so many athletes come close to the finish line and they slow down. It's just a natural thing to do. And so many races have been lost. I even watched an Olympic athlete who had been an Olympic gold medalist get to the end of his race and turn and look. That is a no-no. Everybody does that once. I guess he hadn't done it yet. He was in mid-20s and he did it. I did that once. As a sophomore, I got royally chewed out by my coach and I decided to never ever do that again. As he said, I was running in a conference track as a sophomore. And I got a terrific start. I was heading towards the finish line, and I couldn't see anybody. So when I got close, I decided to look and see how where I was going to finish. As my coach put to me later, you watch yourself go from first to fifth. It was on a journey I cared to make, and I never made it again. You got to fix your eyes on what you're going for and go towards that goal. Run through the tape. I think as senior citizens, like myself, not a lot of us integers because of tax reasons. But you know, your race is not over. Your race is not over. My race is not over. I left full-time ministry and went into a part-time ministry, and actually I'm fully retired. But I did not stop serving Jesus Christ. I still get involved in men's work. I still get involved in Sunday school. Occasionally I preach last Sunday. I do these things because I'm still in the race. And I went to a church, and I used to be in the retail business many years before I went into ministry, and I went from town to town to town. And my wife and I had a formula. We'd find a church within 2 weeks, and then within 2 weeks after that, we would be active in some ministry in that church, because every church needs somebody to do something, without exception. I've been in about 10 different churches in my life. When I say I've been involved in churches, I mean I was involved in ministry in each of those churches. Over the years, my wife and I ended up doing about everything there is to do in a church. I was 34 when I entered ministry, and I had done everything there is to do in the church when I walked in the door as a pastor. That gave me a wealth of experience of doing the kinds of things I need to do. So when I got involved in my church in Princeton, I said, where do you need somebody? And I pretty much knew where they were going to tell me to go. So, you know what? I'm qualified with a theology degree to serve bagels. Make coffee, and do it all in the name of Jesus, and clean tables up. So break this, yes. Need help, see Rick after service. I'm qualified also to listen to Bible verses to little kids. I ran Bible clubs for years, and I know they always need people. So I went down there, and I checked kids out Bible verses and to see if they did their Bible lessons. I remember going from kid to kid, and I'm looking down, and here's this little boy, he's about 9. And I sit down next to him, 8 or 9, and he just starts looking at me. And I said, do you have your Bible verse? And I checked him right out. He didn't know a word of Bible verse. And okay. So I taught him how to learn the Bible verse. So the chunking, you know, you learn about 3 or 4 words at a time, and you build up to person. Then I went to his book. He guessed that he had done nothing in his book. So I showed him how to do the Bible lessons in his book. The next meeting I show up and I'm going through every kid, checking the work, and signing their work so they get the badges. And I go to this kid and he's kind of beaming, he's smiling, he's looking at me. And so I listened to his verse. He looked cool. I looked at his Bible lesson. He'd done everything just that I expected. So I made some inquiries. Who is this boy? Who is this little boy? And I found out this kid has no father. There's no man in his life who validates his existence on the face of this earth. He's looking at these other boys who are sitting down, their fathers are there, helping them learn the verse, helping them do the passages. And he's green, perhaps heavy, and solid. And so when I sat down, he just looked at me and beamed as somebody, a man, paid attention to him. That kid showed up every meeting and learned everything about this. I reflect on an older woman, a couple older women, who taught me, and I was, you might find this hard to believe, I was not really all that good a kid. My wife is at home watching this. And I had to be wrestled down and kept in control. And I remember some older women teaching me a Bible verse when I was about 8. A Bible passage, Matthew 6:31-33, that God would use 11 years later, when I was a freshman in college, to lead me to faith in Jesus Christ. There's a job for you to do. There's a work for you to do. There's a race for you to get involved in that only you can do. God has called each of us. He's marked out our race. It's an individual one. The thing about the Olympics of old and today, only one person gets that wreath. But in the Christian world, when we each won our race, all of us can get that victor's wreath. All of us can win the race that God has called us individually to run. So how do you win your race? You train for it. Learn to be a godly person. Grow your heart, love for God, and others. Get your nose into that book every day, 5, 10, 15 minutes. Listen to it on the radio when you're going to work or when you're driving around. Forget what is behind you. Don't dwell in the past. Neither your laurels, your past victories, or your guilt and past things you're not too proud of. Get rid of the things that hang you up and slow you down. Strain. Give every effort to do what God has called you to do. And finish the race. Run through the table. Please bow with me today. Lord, I pray you take these admonitions in your word to get in the race that you marked out for us, to train, to forget the past, to strain towards what is ahead, to fix our eyes on Jesus, the author, so that we will finish the race and bring you praise, honor, and glory because you deserve it. I'm great proud of the Savior. In Jesus' name, amen.